गुड इवनिंग माय डियर स्टूडेंट्स एंड गुड इवनिंग टू एडमिस टेक टीम। आई एम रियली थैंकफुल टू एडमिस टीम फॉर प्रोवाइडिंग मी दिस वंडरफुल अपॉर्चुनिटी टू कंडक्ट दी बूस्टर सेशंस फॉर कॉम्पिटेटिव एग्जामिनेशन। नाउ द सब्जेक्ट व्हिच वी आर डिस्कसिंग दैट इज फिजिक्स एंड वी विल बी मूविंग फॉरवर्ड टू द डे टू पोर्शन ऑफ द फिजिक्स बूस्टर सेशन। नाउ इफ वी हैव अ क्विक रिव्यू ऑफ द कंटेंट्स व्हिच वी आर अबाउट टू कवर अप इन दिस एंटायर बूस्टर सेशन सीरीज देन we will be covering up the contents from mechanics, heat, optics, sound, and electricity and magnetism. Now, in day one, we had already finished off with the mechanics portion. Now, for today's agenda, we'll be covering up the topics from heat, that is specific heat and latent heat. Then after we have the kinetic theory of gases to be discussed. We'll also be discussing second law of thermodynamics, first law of thermodynamics, and conduction, convection, and radiation. So these are the topics which we'll be covering up in our today's session. So let's get started with the prime agenda, that is specific heat and latent heat. The entire heat content is displayed over here. So starting off with the specific heat and latent heat. Now, when I'm talking about this entire heat portion, so it generally is follows from the subject of thermodynamics, which is a branch of science and engineering specifically dealing with the study of heat and heat transfers. So first it is important to note over here that what is heat. Okay, so heat is a form of energy which is also called as thermal energy, which flows from a hotter or higher temperature body to a lower temperature body which is colder as compared to the one and when they are placed in contact. So heat or thermal energy of a body is the sum of kinetic energies of all its constituent particles on account of translational, vibrational, and rotational motion. Now, the SI unit of heat energy is joule, and the practical energy which we generally utilize, that is calorie. Now, this unit you might have come across if you are a gym enthusiast. Okay, that means if you are regularly exercising it, then your gym trainer or your diet coach might be on a regular basis utilizing this word that burn your calories. Okay, so one calorie is equivalent to 4.18 joules. Now, calorie is the unit, is the quantity of heat which is required to raise the temperature of 1 gram of water by 1 degree Celsius. That is, we can state it from 14.5 degree Celsius to 15.5 degree Celsius. So mechanical energy or work can be converted into heat by using this equation, that is W is equal to J into Q, wherein J is the joule's mechanical equivalent of heat, and J is also a conversion factor, which is not ultimately a physical quantity whose value is 4.186 joule per calorie. So this is the relation between work and heat. Okay, if the mechanical energy or work and heat are to be related, then we can utilize this particular relation for that. Now, triple point of thermal water, that is the values of pressure and temperature at which the water coexist in equilibrium in all the three states of matter we know, that is the solid, liquid, and gas. So solid state is ice, liquid state is water, and gaseous state is vapor. And that particular point where it wherein all the three states of water coexist, that is called as the triple point of water, and that is generally 273 Kelvin temperature and 0.46 centimeter of mercury pressure. This is the pressure and temperature condition wherein the triple point is existing. So this particular values are to be memorized just for the MCQ type questions. So you can either take a screenshot of this and then we may proceed further. Once it is done, please inform me in the chat window with a Y. All right. Now we will discuss the specific heat. So specific heat is the amount of heat required to raise the temperature of unit mass of substance through 1 degree Celsius, that is called as the specific heat. Now, there is a key difference between specific heat and calorie. What did you notice in calorie portion? That it is the quantity of heat required to raise the temperature of 1 gram of water. Okay, whereas If we talk about the specific heat, it is dealing with the amount of heat required to raise the temperature of unit mass of a substance through 1 degree Celsius. So observe the key difference wherein the specific heat and the previous fundamental is related. So ultimately, calorie and specific heat might be seemed to be sometimes confusing, but you need to be very sure when you are solving the MCQs. Okay, so do take a note of it, that which substance or what is specifically mentioned in the question, and accordingly you need to select your option, that whether it is specific heat or whether it is calorie. So ultimately, specific heat is sometimes denoted by C or sometimes it is denoted by S. It depends on the type of paper setter who is setting the paper. He utilizes the notation. So either C is found as a notation of specific heat in some textbooks, and similarly S is also found as the notation for specific heat. Now the SI unit corresponding to this particular fundamental, that is specific heat, is joule per kilogram degree Celsius or joule per kilogram Kelvin, and its dimensional formula is L2 T minus 2 and theta minus 1. Okay, now the specific heat of water, that is 4200 joule per kg per degree Celsius, or we can also write it as 1 calorie per gram per degree degree Celsius inverse. Okay, so which is high as compared with most other substance. Now gases generally have two specific heats, that is the specific heat at constant volume and the specific heat at constant pressure. So specific heat at constant pressure is greater than specific heat at constant volume for gases, that is Cp is always greater than Cv, and that is why the ratio for Cp by Cv is generally denoted by gamma, that is equal to Cp by Cv, and this ratio is equal to 1.4 for an ideal gas or air. So for molar specific heats, we utilize this particular equation, that is Cp minus Cv equals R, wherein this capital R is the gas constant, and this relation is known as the Mayer's formula. So in the MCQ, it can also be asked that what is Mayer's formula, and you will be provided with options like Cp minus Cv is equal to R, then Cv minus Cp is equal to R, Cp plus Cv is equal to R, and none of these. So you need to select Cp minus Cv is equal to R. Okay, so these kind of questions can be framed for the MCQ, and you are supposed to select it wisely. Now, as I've already mentioned, that the ratio of two principal specific heats of a gas is represented by gamma, that is given as gamma is equal to Cp upon Cv, wherein the value of gamma depends on atomicity of gas, whether it is monoatomic, diatomic or triatomic depends on that particular condition. Now, amount of heat required to change the temperature of any given substance can be computed using this particular equation which is stated over here, that is Q is equal to mc delta T, wherein the notation C is utilized, as you can found as you can find for this particular equation. So C ultimately stands for specific heat of that particular substance, M is the mass of the substance, and delta T is the change in temperature which is observed. And this equation is more significantly utilized in the simplification of many of the problems dealing with the heat particular portion. Then after, we will revise the fundamental from thermal heat capacity. So heat capacity of any body is equal to the total amount of the heat energy which is required to increase its temperature to through 1 degree Celsius. So heat capacity is also known as MC. Okay, heat capacity is also known as MC. So as you notice that this definition of heat capacity is also related with the other two definitions which you have studied just before few minutes, that is the definition of calorie and the definition of specific heat. But the key difference is that here the change in temperature is delta T is 1 degree Celsius, so delta T is not written. Okay, so heat capacity is equal to MC, wherein C is equal to specific heat of the substance and M is the mass of the body. And its SI unit is taken to be joule per Kelvin, wherein the dimensional formula for this particular fundamental, that is heat capacity, is ML2T minus 2K minus 1. Okay, so dimensional formula is to be observed for the parameters which we are focusing for any of the physics concept. Why? Because the dimensional formula oriented questionnaires can also be framed in the multiple choice questions. Okay, now dimensional formula questions can be you can easily able to make this dimensional formula based on the unit. So only memorize the unit for it and try to frame the dimensional formula if you are unable to remember it. This is the key to solve these kind of questions. So molar specific heat capacity, that is given as C is equal to S upon mu, wherein we can further utilize this particular part as delta Q by delta T, and mu is already present in the denominator, so S is equal to delta Q by delta T. Now mu is the number of moles of substance of gas, wherein the relation between C and M are given as C is equal to M into S, wherein M is the molecular mass of substance and S is the specific heat capacity. Then after the water equivalent, if we wish to find out that it is the quantity of water whose thermal capacity is same as the heat capacity of the body, and it is denoted by capital W, wherein W is equal to MS, that is equal to the heat capacity of the body, and it is expressed in the unit grams. Now moving further with the other part of this particular content, that is specific heat and latent heat. So specific heat fundamental, the key parts we already discussed. Now let us switch our focus to the next part, that is latent heat. Now generally heat which we observe for the thermodynamics portion, point of view, that is generally in two different parts, that is either it is sensible heat, either it is latent heat. So what is latent heat? Let's try to discuss. Okay, so for that I will first try to make you understand the basics of it. Generally heat is found in two different parts, that is sensible heat. And latent heat. So sensible heat is generally for the rise of temperature. Okay, so it is for temperature variation, we can say rise or fall, and this is for the phase change. Okay, so if any substance changes its phase, then the heat responsible for that particular phase change, that is the latent heat, and heat responsible for the change in temperature, that is sensible heat. Okay, so this you need to keep in mind while simplifying multiple choice questions, because sometimes it can be asked that which heat is responsible for phase change, or which heat is responsible for temperature variation. So you need to select it accordingly. Okay, so this is the fundamental which I have added, apart from the one which is already listed. So latent heat or change of state, that is the heat energy absorbed or released at constant temperature per unit mass for change of state, and heat energy which is absorbed or released during this change of state is given by Q is equal to ML, wherein M is the mass of the substance and L is the latent heat. Now the unit for latent heat which is utilized, that is calorie per grams or joule per kilograms. And its dimensional formula is given as L2 T minus 2. Okay, now two examples are provided for the better understanding of this latent heat fundamental. That is, first example is after snowfall, the temperature of the atmosphere becomes very low, and this is because the snow which is falling, it absorbs the heat from the atmosphere to melt down. So what happens certainly that in the mountains when snowfall happens, but does not feel too cold, but when ice is melting, he or she might be feeling cold. Okay, so this is the key parameter, because the ice is absorbing the surrounding heat, and due to that reason the coldness is felt by the person. Now the second example is there is more shivering effect observed of ice cream on teeth as compared to that of water. Okay, why? Because this is when ice cream melts down, it absorbs a large amount of heat from the teeth. So these two examples are kept for the better understanding of this concept latent heat. Okay, wherein the phase change is is happening over there, and the heat which is responsible for this particular change of phase, that is the latent heat. Now Joule's law, which is the most important law when we discuss the fundamental of heat. Now, according to Joule, whenever heat is converted into work or work is converted into heat, then the ratio of between work and heat is constant. And this is ultimately known as Joule's constant or mechanical equivalent of heat. Okay, so W by Q is equal to J. This equation we already studied, W is equal to JQ. And from that, we obtain the ratio of work and heat as that is equal to Joule. Okay, so J is the mechanical equivalent of heat. Now we'll simplify few problems based on the fundamental of specific heat and latent heat. So first problem is, if the temperature of 10 gram of mercury having the heat specific heat capacity as 140 joule per kg per Kelvin is to be raised from 0 degree Celsius to 100 degree Celsius, then how much heat in joules is required? Your options as displayed are 1400 joules, 1.4 into 10 to 4 joules, 1.4 into 10 to 5 joules and 140 joules. So we need to simplify this question. First, we'll note down the parameters which we are provided with. That is, mass of mercury is given to us. So I will write down as M is equal to 10 gram. Now, since it is given in gram and over here the unit is in kilograms, so I will convert this into kilograms as 0.01 kg. Now, the specific heat capacity value is given to us as S is equal to, see, I am utilizing this S notation for specific heat capacity. Okay, you can also utilize C. Now, it is given as 140 joule per kg per Kelvin. And delta T, that is, see, it is to be raised from 0 to 100. So delta T value is ultimately 100 minus 0. So it is 100 degrees Celsius. I'm directly writing it over here. So now the formula which we are utilizing to find out that how much heat is required, that is given as Q is equal to MS delta T. And if you substitute all the values, it is 0.01 can be written as 1 by 100. I will rewrite over here as 1 by 100. And S value is 140. Delta T value is 100. Though it is 100 degrees Celsius, I will regard it right over here as it is. Okay. Now, both the zeros are getting eliminated and the final answer is, yes, I can find many of the answers in the chat window and it is correct. So it turns out to be 140 joules. Okay, so the prime formula which for this kind of questions, that is Q is equal to MS delta T, and then further simplification steps are to be followed for the correct answer. Problem two, if 1 kilogram of food absorbs 200 kilojoules of heat energy and its temperature changes from 25 degrees Celsius to 150 degrees Celsius. So what will be the specific heat heat of food? Now, once again, the options are given to us as 2000 joule per kg per degree Celsius, 1600, 1000 and 4000 joule per kg per degree Celsius. The same formula is to be utilized. Now, in this case, see, heat is absorbed. Okay. So heat lost by the system is considered as negative and heat gained by the system is considered as positive. So over here Q value 200 kilojoule is positive. So I will write Q is equal to positive 200 or simply 200 kilojoules. Then we have mass as 1 kg and temperature change delta T. It is 150 minus 25. So it is 125. Right, and S value we are supposed to calculate. Now see, in this case we are having the specific heat capacity in joule per kg per degree Celsius, so we need to convert this 200 kilojoules value to joules. So that is 200 and further that three zeros of this kilo is to be put down over here, so it turns out to be 2 lakh joules. And then you are good to go with the simplification steps. Yes, very good. I can find many of the answers. That seems to be correct. But still, let me try to solve this problem. is equal to ms delta t. Value of q is 2 lakh. That is equal to m is 1. S we need to calculate, and 125 is kept as it is. So S is equal to 2 lakh upon 125, and that gives you the answer as 1600 after simplification. All right. So this is how we simplify the questions based on the specific heat and latent heat. One more problem based on this topic, that is, if 100 gram of iron at 20 degrees Celsius temperature is given 2250 joules of heat, then its temperature will rise to how much degrees Celsius? We need to take the specific heat capacity of iron to be 450 joules per kg Kelvin. Now, once again, the simplification steps are similar. We will utilize the same formula for the simplification aspect, that is, Q is equal to ms delta T. Now, instead of using delta T, I will write specifically as T2 minus T1, okay, wherein T2 is the final temperature, T1 is the initial temperature. All right, so let me substitute the values. First of all, I will list down the values as M is equal to 100 grams, which is equal to 1 by 10 kg. Then after Q is equal to 2250 joules. Then we have T1 as 20 degrees Celsius. T2 we need to find out. So substitute these values, 2250 is equal to 1 by 10. Okay, into S value is 450. Into T2, which we are intended to find, and T1 value is 20. So this 0 and this 0 gets cancelled out. Now 2250 upon 45. Okay, we know that 45 into 5 is 225, so I will write 5 and 0. So the simplification is 50. Once you bring down this 45 to the 2250, and T2 minus 20. So T2 is equal to 50 plus 20, that gives you the answer as 70. So the steps are very easy for the simplification, and yes, I can find many of the responses in the chat window, and that is correct. So final answer is 70 degrees Celsius. So generally in specific heat and latent heat, we need to simplify the questions which are generally asked like these kind of formats, that is Q is equal to ms delta t kind of questions may be asked to you, or the fundamental based questions can be asked to you. Okay, now let's focus on to the next part of the today's presentation, that is kinetic theory of gas. Now to understand the fundamental of kinetic theory of gases, the prime objective for this particular is that it explains the behavior of gases, and also it correlates the macroscopic properties of gases, that is pressure, temperature, etc., to the microscopic properties like speed, momentum, kinetic energy, etc. Now, a few of the assumptions you need to take care of while dealing with the kinetic theory of gases, that is, every gas consists of extremely small particles, which are known as molecules, and these molecules, the molecules of a given gas are all identical but are different from those of another gas. Now, the molecules of a gas are identical, spherical, rigid, and perfectly elastic point masses. Okay, their molecular size is negligible in comparison to the intermolecular distance, that is approximately of the order of 10 raised to minus 9 meters. Also, the speed of gas molecules lies between 0 and infinity, and generally it is very high speed. Okay, the interactions are at very vigorous rate. The further assumptions which you need to take care of, that is the distance covered by the molecules between two successive collisions is known as free path, and mean of all free path is called as the mean free path. Now the number of collisions per unit volume in a gas remains constant. Then after, no attractive or repulsive forces prevails between gas molecules, and gravitational attraction among the molecules is ineffective due to extremely small masses, which are generally negligible, and also the velocities are very high, so we can neglect the mass at this point of time. Also, the density of gas is constant at all the points of the vessel, and the molecule of a gas keep on moving randomly in all possible directions with all possible velocities. So these were few assumptions which you need to take care of while dealing with the kinetic theory of gas fundamentals. Now we'll try to observe few of the prime gas laws. There are generally three gas laws which are to be observed, that is Boyle's law, Charles' law, and Gay-Lussac's law. Okay, so starting off with the very first part, that is Boyle's law. Now to remember that which law is following which particular parameter, that is in Boyle's law we will observe that temperature is constant. Okay, in Boyle's law temperature is constant. In a similar way, in Charles' law pressure is constant, and in Gay-Lussac's law volume is constant. So to memorize this in a shorter way, the way which is preferred, that is BT, CP, and GV. Okay, BT, CP, GV. This we generally tend to memorize, that in Boyle's law temperature is constant, in Charles' law pressure is constant, and in Gay-Lussac's law volume is constant. So this is how we generally tend to memorize the key part of these laws, and then we will proceed further. Okay, this will readily help you out to make you understand and also to memorize the concept. Okay, for the further simplification of multiple choice questions. Now, at constant temperature, the volume of a given mass of a gas is inversely proportional to its pressure. Okay, so in Boyle's law, temperature is generally constant. So the graph, when it is plotted for V to V versus P, or PV diagram if it is plotted, so we observe that volume is inversely proportional to pressure, and we can write it once we try to when we try to substitute this constant of proportionality with any constant value. So it turns out to be PV is equal to constant. So for any of the given gas, we can say that P1 V1 is equal to P2 V2, wherein 1 and 2 are the states of the gases. Okay, that is initial state and final state. So this is the key part of this Boyle's law. This you need to understand, P1 V1 is equal to P2 V2. Thereafter, we'll discuss the Charles' law. So in Charles' law, we have the pressure is constant. So at constant pressure, the volume of a given mass of gas is directly proportional to its absolute temperature. So we can say that volume is directly proportional to temperature. So volume upon temperature bears a constant ratio. So we can mathematically put down V1 upon T1 is equal to V2 upon T2 for any two states of a gas, that is initial state and final state. Okay. Also, it is important to note that at constant pressure, the volume of a given mass of a gas increases or decreases by 1 upon 273.15 of its volume at 0 degree Celsius for each unit rise of temperature, each 1 degree Celsius rise or fall in temperature. So volume of the gas at T degree Celsius, that is given as Vt is equal to V0 1 plus T upon 273.15. This is the equation which you need to look forward for the MCQ type questions. And this is the graph pertaining to the Charles' law. It is plotted for volume and temperature. Okay. So V0 is the volume of gas at 0 degree Celsius and Vt is the volume of gas at T degree Celsius. Now, either of the parameters will be provided to you. Let's say V0 is provided to you, T is provided to you. So you need to find Vt and substitute the values and you obtain the answer. This is the particular format which we follow for the MCQ type questions. Then after, Gay-Lussac's law, or it is also known as Regnault's law. Now, in Gay-Lussac's law, as I've already mentioned, the volume is remaining constant. So the pressure of a given mass of a gas is directly proportional to its absolute temperature. So P is directly proportional to T. So pressure and temperature bears a constant ratio. Okay. And that is generally given for two different states. If we like to put down in mathematical format, then it is P1 upon T1 is equal to P2 upon T2. And at constant volume, like we had seen for the Charles' law, we will see similarly for the Gay-Lussac's law, that is at constant volume, the pressure of a given mass of gas increases or decreases by an amount 1 upon 273.15 of its pressure at 0 degree Celsius for each 1 degree Celsius rise or fall in its temperature. So volume of the gas at T degree Celsius is given as PT is equal to P0 into bracket 1 plus T upon 273.15, wherein P0 is the pressure of gas at 0 degree Celsius. And this is the graph which is plotted for pressure and temperature. All right. Now we'll look forward to the Avogadro's law. So Avogadro's law, that is stated that equal volume of all the gases under similar conditions of temperature and pressure contain equal number of molecules. And this statement is called as Avogadro's hypothesis. So according to Avogadro's law, N1 is equal to N2, wherein N1 and N2 are the number of molecules in two gases respectively. Okay, so Avogadro's number, that is given as the number of molecules present in 1 gram of 1 gram mole of a gas, that is defined as Avogadro's number, that is given as Na is equal to 6.023 into 10 raised to 23 per gram mole. So at standard temperature of pressure or normal temperature of pressure, that is T is equal to 273 Kelvin and P is equal to 1 atmospheric pressure, the 22.4 liter of each gas has 6.023 into 10 raised to 23 molecules. And 1 mole of any gas at STP occupies 22.4 liters of volume. Okay. So this thing you need to understand for Avogadro's law. Now let us quickly look at the Dalton's law of partial pressure, wherein states that the total pressure of a mixture of non-interacting ideal gases is the sum of partial pressures exerted by individual gases in the mixture. So P is equal to P1 plus P2 plus P3 up to how many the mixture of gases which we take forward to, that we will. Okay. So this we need to take care of. After that, ideal or perfect gas equation, that is gases which obey the all gas laws in all conditions of pressure and temperature are called as perfect gases, wherein the equation of perfect gas is given as PV is equal to nRT. So P is equal to pressure, V is equal to volume, T is equal to absolute temperature, R is equal to universal gas constant, and N is equal to number of moles of a gas. So universal gas constant R has the value as 8.31 joule per mole per Kelvin. Now, the fundamental of real gas, it states that real gases deviate slightly from ideal gas laws. Why? Because real gas molecules attract one another and real gas molecules occupy a finite volume. Okay. So real or van der Waals gas equation can be, it can be framed as below, that is P plus A upon V square into bracket V minus P is equal to RT, wherein A and B are called as van der Waals constants. So the dimension of A is ML5T minus 2 and dimension of B is L3. Units of A, that is Newton meter raised to 4, and B is equal to meter cube. And we need to note over here that real gases obey this equation at high pressure and low temperature. Now, I would like to request you all to take the screenshot of this. Why? Because sometimes dimension of A and B are to be asked. Also, sometimes unit is to be asked. So take a screenshot and do reply me in the chat window once it is done. All right. Now, pressure of a gas. So pressure due to an ideal gas is given by P is equal to 1 upon 3 mn upon V, V square. That is also rewritten as 1 upon 3 rho V bar square. So for 1 mole of an ideal gas, the pressure is given as 1 upon 3 m upon capital V, V bar square, wherein m is equal to mass of one molecule, n is equal to number of molecules, and V is equal to volume of gas. So V bar is generally taken as square root of V bar 1 square, V bar 2 square, V up to n times of V bar square, the whole divided by small n, wherein this particular v bar is called as the root mean square velocity of the gas molecules, and m is called as the molecular weight of the gas. So these equations are sometimes of prime importance when we talk about the MCQ type questions. So do take a screenshot of this and reply me in the chat window. All right. Then after, if P is the pressure of the gas and E is the kinetic energy per unit volume, then pressure and kinetic energy per unit volume for a gas can be related by this relation as P is equal to 2 upon 3E. Now it is important to note over here that effect of mass, volume and temperature on pressure, that is when volume and temperature of a gas are constant, then pressure is proportional to mass of gas. Okay, so these are the noteworthy points for MCQ type of questions, that is when volume and temperature of a gas are constant, then pressure is directly proportional to mass of gas. When mass and temperature of a gas are constant, then pressure is inversely proportional to volume. And when mass and volume of a gas are constant, then pressure is directly proportional to temperature, which is directly proportional to square of the specific heat. So these noteworthy points are of prime part related to the MCQ type questions. Now, kinetic energy of a gas and speed of a gas. And now, as I can find that we are having time constraint, so what I can do is I can I will not go through entire content of the slide, just the prime part, that is the average kinetic energy of translation per molecule, that is given as E is equal to 3 upon 2 kT, wherein this K is the Boltzmann constant. And similarly, average kinetic energy of translation per mole of a gas, over here molecule is there, over here 1 mole of gas is taken. So for that, E is equal to 3 upon 2 RT, wherein R is the universal gas constant. Okay. Then after, for a given gas, kinetic energy is directly proportional to, okay, E is directly proportional to this T. So E1 upon T1 is equal to E1 upon E2 is equal to T1 upon T2. Now the root mean square velocity of the gas molecules, this is the prime part of the discussion, kinetic energy of molecules. This root mean square velocity based questions are many times asked in the examination, wherein let's say you are provided with the molecules as hydrogen and helium, okay, and then you are supposed to compare the root mean square velocities. So to simplify these kind of questionnaires, you need to memorize this equation primarily. So do take a note of it. V is equal to under root of 3 RT upon M, that is also equal to under root of 3 P upon the density, that is rho. So for a given gas, root mean square velocity is directly proportional to temperature if the other parameters are constant, and also it is inversely proportional to square root of the molar mass as the other parameters are constant. So V is directly proportional to under root of T, or V is inversely proportional to under root of M. These two results are of key part for the discussion. Okay. Then after, Boltzmann constant K is equal to R upon N, wherein R is the and N is the Avogadro number. Now the value of Boltzmann constant is given as 1.38 into 10 raised to minus 28 joule per Kelvin. The average speed of molecules, probable speed, these are sometimes asked, so no need to prime focus on these two portions. We'll focus on the further part, that is with rise in temperature, RMS speed of gas molecules increases. Why? Because VRMS is directly proportional to square root of T. And with increase in molecular weight, the RMS speed of gas molecule will decrease. Why? Because VRMS is inversely proportional to molecular weight. So RMS speed of gas molecules is of the order of kilometer per second. That is, for example, at normal temperature and pressure for hydrogen gas, if you look out, then VRMS is equal to 1.84, wherein once you substitute the values of R, T and M, you will obtain this answer 1.84. Now degree of freedom fundamental, that is for a dynamic system, okay, degree of freedom For a dynamic system, it is the number of directions in which the particle can move freely, or the total number of coordinates which are required to describe completely the position. Okay, so it is denoted by f or n, whatever the notations you utilize. So f or n, that is equal to 3a minus r, and a is equal to the number of particles in the system, and r is equal to number of independent relations between the particles. This equation is the important part. And degree of freedom for different atomic particles are given. For monoatomic gas, it is 3. For diatomic gas, it is 5. That is 3 translational and 2 rotational degree of freedom you have for a gas, diatomic gas. For nonlinear triatomic gas, it is 6, wherein 3 translational and 3 rotational movements are, you know, there. And for linear triatomic gas, it is 7, wherein 3 translational, 3 rotational, and 1 vibrational. One vibrational degree of freedom is to be observed. So these four results are of utmost importance when it takes to MCQ simplification. So I request everyone to once again take the screenshot of this particular slide, especially this degree of freedom for different atomic particles, that you need to memorize it. All right. Then after specific heat of a gas at constant volume, that is Cv is given as F upon 2 R, and Cp is given as F upon 2 plus 1 into R. So ratio of specific heats of gas at constant pressure and at constant volume is given by gamma is equal to 1 plus 2 upon F, wherein specific heat of solid, that is C, is equal to 3 R, and specific heat of water, that is C, is equal to 9 R. Now, we'll simplify a few problems based on this particular fundamental. So problem one, that is, at what temperature will volume of an ideal gas becomes 3 times than that at 0 degree Celsius at constant pressure? So to simplify these kind of questions, the fundamental which you are utilizing it, that is very easy. See, what is given, that constant pressure condition is provided to us. Okay. So for constant pressure, what is the formula? Volume is directly proportional to temperature. Okay. So V1 upon T1 is equal to V2 upon T2. This is the fundamental which we'll be utilizing it. So in this case, what temperature will volume of an ideal gas becomes 3 times? Okay. So V2 is equal to 3 times of V1. Can we relate this mathematical equation formulation from this particular statement? So V2 is equal to 3 times of V1. So V1 upon V2, from this, it turns out to be 1 upon 3, if you further simplify it. And I will reuse this result right over here. That is V1 upon V2 is equal to T1 upon T2. Okay. V1 upon V2, that is 1 upon 3. So 1 upon 3 is equal to T1. T1 is 20 degrees, is 0 degrees Celsius. So it is 273 Kelvin. And T2 we need to find out. So T2 is equal to 273 into 3. That gives you the answer as 819, but as it is in Kelvin, we need to convert it into degree Celsius. So once you convert it into degree Celsius, it turns out to be 546 degree Celsius. Okay, it is, you need to take 273 reduction over here. And yes, I can find many of the answers in the chat window. But see, A, many of you have answered A, it is ultimately option C. Okay. You need to convert it in degree Celsius. Next, we will have a look at the first law of thermodynamics portion. So first law of thermodynamics, that is, heat given to a thermodynamic system is partially utilized in doing work delta W against the surrounding, and the remaining part increases the internal energy of the system. This is the first law of thermodynamics. And if you want to utilize the mathematical expression for this first law, then it is given as delta Q is equal to delta U plus delta W. And in differential form, it is the dq is equal to du plus dw. So first law of thermodynamics is a restatement of the principle of conservation of energy. Now delta u is the change in internal energy of the system. Now I request everyone to take the screenshot of this slide, because these are the guiding parameters which is kept over here. So it depends, delta u depends only on initial and final state of the system, and if temperature of system increases, then delta u is positive. If temperature of a system decreases, then it is negative, and it is a function which depends only on temperature of the system. Then if we talk about the delta q parameter, then change, it is the change in heat energy of the system. So if heat is given to the system, delta q is positive. If heat is lost by the system, then delta q is negative. And for work done, if work done is by the system, its volume increases, so delta w is positive, and if work is done on the system, its volume decreases, so delta w is negative. Now first law of thermodynamics for different processes. So generally process which we'll observe over here, that is isothermal, adiabatic, isobaric and isochoric. Four processes we'll be looking forward to, starting off with the first process, that is isothermal process. So as the name suggests, the isothermal, iso that means same, thermal that means something which is dealing with temperature. So temperature remains constant during this entire process, wherein if you take the plot, okay, if you take the plot of this particular, it turns out to be PV diagram is given right, as you can find over here, it follows this kind of curve. So delta T change in temperature is zero, which ultimately results into the change in internal energy to be zero. So if you utilize this result in the first law of thermodynamics, you will come up with this particular result as delta Q is equal to delta W. Now for work done in isothermal process, you need to memorize this particular result, that is 2.303 mu RT log P1 by P2, or 2.303 mu RT log V2 by V1. So generally this work done result is to be taken care of, and this delta Q. Okay, now moving ahead with the next process of discussion, that is the adiabatic process. Adiabatic process wherein the exchange of heat energy between system and surrounding is zero, so there is no heat transfer. Okay, so delta U is equal to minus delta W from the first law of thermodynamics, wherein delta Q is taken as zero. So if work is done by the system, then delta U is negative, and work is done on the system, then delta U is positive. And if you wish to take a plot for this PV diagram, adiabatic process, then it follows this kind of curve, which you can find right over here. And work done can be found out using this integral of P delta V. So it is ultimately given as P1 V1 minus P2 V2 upon gamma minus 1, which can also be rewritten as, since PV is equal to mu RT, so it can be written as mu RT1 minus P2. Okay. Now relation between PV and T can be given as PV raised to gamma is equal to constant, or TV raised to gamma minus 1 is equal to constant, or TP raised to 1 minus gamma upon gamma is equal to constant for this adiabatic process. Okay. Then we have the isobaric process. Now, since isobaric process includes word bar over here, so we know that bar is the unit of pressure. So it follows the constant pressure system. So the pressure of the system remains constant, and delta P is said to be zero. Utilize this in the from the first law of thermodynamics, we have delta Q is equal to du plus dw. So dw can be it can be written as P delta V, wherein P delta V can be further written as nr dt. Okay, P dv is equal to nr dt. So this is the equation of work done for isobaric process. And if we wish to take a plot of it, you can observe right over here, it's a horizontal line of the PV diagram. Thereafter, the isochoric process. Now, since volume is remaining constant, so work done will be zero. It is very logical. Okay. Only the pressure rise is observed. That is, the initial pressure is at state one over here, final pressure is at state two. Okay. And the only the change of pressure is happening, no volume is getting changed, so work done will be zero in this particular process, that is isochoric. Okay, so delta U is equal to delta Q is the equation for this particular. Now for isolated system, delta Q is zero, delta U is zero, and delta W is zero. And heat capacity, HC is given as delta Q by delta T, where in the unit of heat capacity is calorie per degree Celsius or joule per Kelvin. It depends on the type and mass of substance. And specific heat, it is given as HC by M, which is equal to delta Q upon M delta T. And it depends only on type of substance. Okay, specific heat is not depending on mass. You can find that mass is right over here in the denominator. So it is independent of mass. Thereafter, specific heat of gas at constant volume and at constant pressure. We have already discussed this thing, so I will skip at this moment. And we'll try to simplify our problem based on it. That is, during a thermodynamic process, 1000 joule heat is lost on doing 1000 work. So the change in its internal energy will be how much? Now see, to simplify this question, first of all, you need to understand the concept that heat is lost by the system, so heat will be taken as negative. And since work is done on the system, it is considered as negative. So both the values I will take negative over here. Okay, so Q value, delta Q value is equal to minus 1000 and delta W value is equal to minus 100. Now use the formula for first law of thermodynamics, that is delta Q is equal to delta W plus delta U. And find out the value for delta U. So once you substitute it, minus 1000 is equal to minus 100 plus delta U. So delta U on further simplification, it turns out to be minus 900. Yes, very good. I can find 3 to 4 responses in the chat. So the final answer turns out to be option A, that is minus 900 joules. Then after, if gamma is the ratio of specific heats, okay, if gamma is the ratio of specific heats and R is a gas constant, then molar specific heat at constant pressure Cp, that is given as what? Now to simplify this, we'll use that Mayer's equation, that is Cp minus Cv equals R. Now what is asked? Cp is asked, so I need to take Cp common from this particular equation. So Cp is taken outside. So if I take Cp outside, it is 1 minus Cv upon Cp is equal to R. Now I will subject Cp at one end and I will bring down the entire bracket over here in the denominator. Now I can rewrite this Cv by Cp as 1 upon Cp by Cv. Okay, the Cv can be taken as denominator of denominator. So 1 minus 1 upon, now see, Cp by Cv is known as gamma. So it is 1 minus 1 upon gamma. That is equal to, if we take the simplification step over here, this gamma, which is denominator of denominator, after simplification, it goes to the numerator. So it is gamma R upon gamma minus 1. Which is none other than option C. Similarly, students, you can be asked for the value of Cv also. Okay, so you can take the further simplification steps and solve for Cv. So at this point of time, the answer for this is option C, that is gamma R upon gamma minus 1. Now, problem 3, it is very easy. We need to observe this graph and we need to find out that in figure, which process represents isothermal, isochoric, and isobaric. So for pressure volume graph, okay, PV diagram, we know that if these two states are changed, okay, so if you observe that pressure is remaining constant. So for 1 to 2, it is isobaric, okay. So isobaric is in third particular value. If we write down this particular in a chronological order, so 1, 2 is in last part in which particular given options? So it is none other than option C. Only focus on basics, okay? And then based on it, we can able to identify that, okay, this is the final answer. Okay, so if you observe, this is 1, 2, 2 is isobaric, 3, 2, 4 is isochoric, volume is remaining constant, and 2, 2, 3, okay, this is isothermal process. So answer is option C. Then after we'll have a look at second law of thermodynamics. So when we discuss the second law of thermodynamics, it gives us the fundamental limitation to the efficiency of a heat engine and the coefficient of performance of a refrigerator. Now, it certainly says that efficiency of heat engine can never be unity or 100%. Why? Because if it happens, then every vehicle will give us the mileage of more than 1,000 or 2,000 kilometers per liter, okay, which is practically not possible. So this implies that heat released to the cold reservoir can never be made zero. We have three statements to look out for the second law of thermodynamics, that is Kelvin statement, Clausius statement, and Planck statement. So Kelvin stated that it is impossible to obtain a continuous supply of work from a body by cooling it to a temperature below the coldest of its surroundings. Now Clausius stated that it is impossible to transfer heat from a lower temperature body to a higher temperature body without use of any external source. So generally refrigerator is designed based on the Clausius law. Okay, and Planck stated that it is impossible to construct a heat engine that will convert entire heat energy into work done. So all these statements are equivalent as one can be obtained from the other. Now, entropy, the prime fundamental of law of thermodynamics, that is related to the disorderness of the molecular motion of the system. So greater the randomness or the disorderness, greater is the entropy. And this change in entropy is given by TS is equal to dQ upon T, wherein dQ is the heat supplied to the system and T is the absolute temperature. So entropy of a system never decreases. Okay, if you notice that TS value is always either greater or equal to zero. And it is a physical quantity that remains constant during a reversible adiabatic change. Now, adiabatic process, hence it is known as isentropic process also. Okay, adiabatic process, the other name is isentropic process. I'm writing this name over here, isentropic, wherein this isentropic means entropy remains constant. So entropy of a system increases in a reversible process. Okay, in an irreversible process, it increases. So change in entropy for solids and liquids can be given as delta S is equal to delta Q by T, which can be framed for differential part as dS is equal to dQ by T. And dQ is equal to plus or minus ML, wherein L is the latent heat. Okay, so positive sign is used for heat absorption and negative sign is used for heat rejection. And when temperature of a substance changes from T1 to T2, then TS is taken as the integral part for this dQ by T. And further simplification steps will result into 2.303 ms log to the base 10 T2 by T1, wherein m is the mass of the substance and s is the specific heat of the substance. Now, the important part of Carnot, the second law of thermodynamics is the Carnot cycle. Carnot cycle undergoes two isothermal process and two adiabatic process. Okay, if you notice this particular PV diagram, then from A to B, it undergoes the isothermal expansion. From B to C, it undergoes the adiabatic expansion. From C to D, it undergoes the isothermal compression. And from D to A, it undergoes the adiabatic compression. So it follows two isothermal process and two adiabatic process. So Carnot is the name of the scientist who devised an ideal cycle for operation for a heat engine, which is known as Carnot cycle. And it is the ideal cycle, which is generally taken for reference. So the net work done per cycle by this engine is numerically equal to the area of the loop, which you can find right over here, representing the Carnot cycle. So after doing calculations for different processes, we can show that Q2 by Q1 is equal to T2 by T1, wherein the efficiency of the cycle is given as eta is equal to 1 minus T2 upon T1. This is the efficiency equation which we'll be utilizing in many of the numericals. Now, efficiency of Carnot engine is maximum, that is not 100% for given temperatures T1 and T2, but still Carnot engine is not a practical engine. Why? Because many ideal situations have been assumed while designing this engine, which can practically be not obtained. So Carnot cycle is an ideal cycle for heat engine design, but it cannot be constructed on a regular practice. Why? Because we need to take certain assumptions. So according to Carnot theorem, a heat engine working between the two given temperatures as T1 for hot reservoir and T2 for cold reservoir, okay, have efficiency more than that of the Carnot engine. The efficiency of the Carnot engine is independent of the nature of working substance. Now, let us try to simplify a few of the problems based on the fundamentals of thermodynamics, the second law of thermodynamics, that is, a heat engine absorbs 50 kilojoules of heat from the heat source. Okay, its efficiency is 30%. Then it releases how much heat in the sink? Now we have the Q1 value as 50 kilojoules. Efficiency is given to us as 30%. So eta value is 30 by 100, which is equal to 0.3. So how much heat is released into the heat sink? So the process is very easy to calculate. That is, eta is equal to 1 minus Q2 upon Q1. Q2 we are intended to find, which is the heat in sink. Q2 is unknown. Okay. So eta value, that is 0.3. I will take the simplification as Q1. Okay, Q1 value is already provided to us. So it is 50 minus Q2 upon 50. If you take the further simplification, this 50 goes with 0.3 and it turns out to be 15 is equal to 50 minus Q2. So Q2 value is 50 minus 15. That brings you to the value for our answer as 35 kilojoules. So if you notice, the answer is 35 kilojoules. In a similar way, efficiency of Carnot engine is 40% and temperature of sink is 400 Kelvin. Keeping temperature of heat source as constant, if efficiency is to be made 80%, temperature of sink should be made how much? Now to calculate this particular example, once again, we'll follow the same process. The eta value is offered to you as 40%. So we take eta as 0.4. The sink temperature is provided to you. So T2 value is given to you and you need to find out T1. Okay. Then after finding the T1, keep that value as it is and take the value of efficiency to be 80%. So this is eta 1, this is eta 2. Okay. And then temperature of sink is to be found out. Then T2 is equal to what? So utilize the value of T1 which you obtained from this particular first portion in the second case and then find out the temperature of sink. This is the process to be followed for the simplification. So if you try to find out the value of T1, so it can be found out using eta is equal to 1 minus T2 upon T1. Eta is 0.4 is equal to 1 minus 400 upon T1. And if you take the further simplification, T1 is equal to 400 upon 0.6 Kelvin. Okay, you can simplify it. This 400 upon T1 can be brought to left hand side and this 0.4 can be brought to right hand side, and that resultant value can be further simplified to this particular expression. T1 is equal to 400 upon 0.6 Kelvin. Now I am going to utilize this particular value. I will not simplify this at present because it is not my concern at this point of time. So new eta or eta 2, that is equal to 80%, so it is 0.8. We have the temperature of T1 to be utilized from this case, and T2 is to be found out. So once again, I will utilize the same result. 0.8 is equal to 1 minus T2 upon T1 value, that is 400 upon 0.6. So you can take the further simplification steps and calculate the value of T2. So once you undergo the simplification steps thoroughly, it is if you take this T2, this entire parameter towards the left and this 0.8 value towards the right, so it is T2 is equal to 400 upon 0.6 multiplied by 0.2, and for the simplification you will come up with the answer as 133.33 Kelvin. So in the option we have the answer as 133, so I will take option D as my final response, and you can notice that 133 Kelvin is our answer. All right, then after, I'm skipping this portion at present, conduction, convection and radiation. Now to understand this heat transfer fundamental, I will only discuss the theory portion. Why? Because MCQs are very easy to simplify. It is generally based on the equation of conduction or equation of radiation. Two to three parameters might be provided to you, and based on it, you are supposed to calculate the results, okay, which you need to find out. So we'll cover up only theoretical portion for this heat transfer, that is conduction, convection and radiation, overlooking at the time constraint. And that is conduction in solids. It is the heat which is transmitted from higher temperature to lower temperature without actual movements of the particles. And this movement or this mode of transmission of heat is called as conduction. Okay, so conduction happens in a stationary state. Okay, in steady state, we can undergo conduction, and also the bodies needs to be in contact with each other. Okay, then after for convection, it is the process of heat transmission in which the particles of the fluid, whether it is liquid or gas, move, is called as convection. Okay, so land breeze, sea breeze and trade wind are formed due to this convective heat transfer or convection. Now the third important part of the heat transfer, that is radiation. It is defined as the process of heat transmission in the form of electromagnetic waves, and radiation do not require any material medium for propagation. It propagates without heating the intervening medium. So the heat energy transferred by radiation is called as the radiant energy, which we receive from the sun. So heat from the sun reaches the earth by the radiation, okay, mode of heat transfer. Now the conduction of heat in a conducting rod can be calculated using this formula, that is Q is equal to Ka delta theta T upon L, wherein K is the coefficient of thermal conductivity, A is the area of cross section, L is the length of rod, delta theta, that is the temperature difference between the ends of the rod, and T is the time taken for the heat transfer. Now the SI unit of K, that is thermal conductivity, is given as watt per meter per Kelvin, and its dimensional formula is ML T minus 3 theta minus 1. The value of K is large for good conductors and very small for insulators. Then after the thermal current and resistance, so the rate of flow of heat is known as thermal or heat current, and it can be denoted by H, capital H. So H is equal to Ka delta theta upon L, wherein this thermal current is also known as the convective current. Okay, so it is convection formula. So thermal resistance is given by R is equal to del theta upon H, which is equal to L upon Ka. Sometimes this thermal resistance kind of question is can be asked to you, wherein you are provided with the value of L, K and A, and simply substitute the value to obtain the result. So this del theta is the temperature difference at the ends of the rod, and H is the rate of flow of heat. Its SI unit is Kelvin per watt, and its dimensional formula is M minus 1 L minus 1 T3 theta minus 1. When we talk of the two conducting rods connected in series, we need to observe that rate of heat flow, that is given as Q upon T, that is equal to K1A theta 1 minus theta upon L1 is equal to K2A theta minus theta 2 upon L2. So temperature of contact surface, that is theta, is given as K1 theta 1 L2 plus K2 theta 2 L1 upon K1 L2 plus K2 L1. Equivalent thermal conductivity H is given as L1 plus L2 upon L1 upon K1 plus L2 upon K2. And equivalent thermal resistance is taken as R is equal to R1 plus R2. So when two conducting rods are connected in parallel, the rate of heat flow, it turns out to be H is equal to Q by T, that is given as K1 A1 upon L is equal to K2 A2 upon L into bracket theta 1 plus theta 2. So temperature gradient theta 1 minus theta 2 upon L, that is the equivalent thermal conductivity K, is given as K1 A1 plus K2 A2 upon A1 plus A2, and equivalent thermal resistance is given as 1 upon R is equal to 1 upon R1 plus 1 upon R2. Then this emissive power is generally utilized for radiation. So it is generally taken, denoted by E lambda, that is equal to 1 upon A into d theta by dt. SI unit is joules, second inverse meter inverse square, or watt per meter square. Dimensional formula is MT minus 3. And this emissivity of a body, it is the ratio of E lambda upon capital E lambda, that is the emissive power, total emissive power of the body, which is taken divided by the emissive power of a perfectly black body. Then the Stefan's law, E is equal to sigma T raised to 4. This is the law for radiation, when the Stefan-Boltzmann constant, that is given as 5.735 into 10 raised to minus 8 watt per meter square Kelvin raised to minus 4. And Wien's displacement law, that is for the wavelength lambda corresponding to which maximum energy is radiated, T is the absolute temperature, and Wien's constant is 2.898 into 10 raised to minus 3. And with this, I hereby come to the end of my today's discussion for HEAT. I would like to thank you all for attending my today's session. And now I would like to hand over this presentation to ADMIS team.